All right, so I will begin with the introduction of the university itself. So University of South Florida is a relatively young institution. Our first classes opened in 1960, and there is a reason why that will be important. It's actually because whenever I tell you about our progress, whenever I tell you about the impact that we make as an institution, I'd like you to remember that we actually started later than other places, but yet we are able to reach and meet and exceed many expectations in a relatively short amount of time. We are already number 10. Largest public university in the United States. So right now we have more than 50,000 students. They are from all over the world. You can actually feel that dynamics. You can feel that on campus. The campus itself is very large. You can now see a video on the slide. It's very modern. There is a lot of constructions going on. There is a lot of expansion. We have a lot of space to grow. So we are very nicely positioned in order to make huge impact and in order to grow further. Okay, so we are classified as R1 doctoral university with very high research activity. And this is especially important for you as future graduate students. This is designation that only about 2.5% of all post-secondary institutions in the United States receive. Very recently, actually just a couple of years ago, we received a very high designation by the state of Florida. Right now, we are one of only 3 preeminent state research universities in the state of Florida. And that is especially important because we started later than other schools, but yet we are able to reach those high expectations imposed by the state in a very short period of time. And that tells you a little bit about the trajectory that we are on right now. Now, very recently, just our last fall, we've been named America's fastest rising research university. And this is once again because of the impact that we're making, because of the incredible speed at which we are growing in the recent year. We have been named, or we have been ranked among the best colleges in the nation by the US News and World Report. Just a couple of more highlights. We are number 1 in the state of Florida and number 7 in the nation among universities, among all public universities, by the US patents granted. What does it tell about us? It tells that we are very creative, we are motivated, we are very innovative. We really want to make sure that not only we do great research, we also get it out there for people to be used. Now, in terms of research expenditures, and this is something very, very important because research expenditures tells you about the amount of money, the amount of dollars that we are able to bring for our research. And this is something that immediately affects all of us and you as graduate students, because you will be engaged in research, and for that we need money. So this metric measures in how successful we are, not only in doing and carrying out our research, but making sure that we have sufficient funding for us. So right now we are number 25 among all public universities for that metric. And we are number 42 in the nation, which is actually very, very good, because you have to put that in the perspective of more than 600 research universities in the United States. So we're doing very well in terms of research funding. We've been ranked number 5 in the nation by the University Impact Ranking. And that is, again, to emphasize exactly the same point. We are very young, but we are very motivated, we are very committed, and we are on an incredible trajectory to make impact in the very shortest amount of time. And I'm not sure about you, but if you're anything or anyone like me, I'd like to be a part of something which is very dynamic, something where you really have that opportunity to make contribution. And you can feel it here. You can feel it on campus. You can definitely feel that in the department. Everyone is very committed. Everyone wants to make difference. And you will actually have the opportunity to make that difference because we're very committed. We want to reach the highest expectations in the shortest amount of time. And this is something that I personally appreciate very much about the University of South Florida. So let me see, I think, yes, but there's one more thing. We are number 14th in student success among more than 1,000 public universities. And student success is something that that is directly translatable to you. We are very committed to our students. We are very committed to our undergraduate students. We are even more committed to our graduate students. We want to make sure that they're successful. We want to make sure that they progress toward the degree, and you will definitely feel that on campus. Okay. So at this point, I think I've said enough to introduce the university itself, and now I'm going to move on to the Department of Physics. And the way I decided to go about that, I will give you a snapshot in the form of short video. And this snapshot, it's actually a little bit dated in time. It's about probably 4 years ago, but after that, I will tell you what has been happening in the department and what has been happening in terms of the further progress. So this will take about 6 or 7 minutes, but this is really very important for you to take a look at our department.
With over 41,000 students, the University of South Florida in Tampa is a global research university dedicated to student success. The Department of Physics is a foundational cornerstone of the School of Natural Sciences and Mathematics, which is in the largest college in the university, the College of Arts and Sciences. Our mission is to excel in the education of our graduate and undergraduate students and to be innovative and impactful in research at the frontiers of scientific knowledge. We are a 21st century physics department, generating new scientific knowledge and graduating students who will improve the human condition. The department has seen exponential growth in its research activity. In particular, our active research grants have now increased to $16 million in 2013. Our young faculty members have received 4 NSF Career Awards in just the past 5 years since 2009. The department has been housed in a new 7-story interdisciplinary science building since the fall of 2011. This building has state-of-the-art facilities both for teaching as well as for research. A particular area in which we have international expertise is in the area of thermoelectric materials, which are used for alternative energy applications.
My laboratory focuses on energy-related technologies, new materials, and new ways of making materials, in order to discover not only new materials, but new approaches as to how to make materials of technological interest. We've recently patented a new synthetic approach we coined the kinetically controlled thermal decomposition, whereby we can make metastable materials that not only have not been synthesized before, but we are actually synthesizing them in single crystal form.
Research in theoretical and computational materials physics spans the range from inorganic functional materials to soft condensed matter.
Some of our achievements include development of very accurate atomistic models to simulate functional materials. In particular, we have developed the first computational model that allows to simulate the change in temperature during solid-state refrigeration cycle directly. In the future, we are looking to discover new materials for efficient energy harvesting, conversion, and conservation, as well as new materials for nanoscale, ultra-fast electronics, and next-generation memory technology.
A particular area of great interest in our department is that of interdisciplinary research in atomic, molecular, and optical physics, which includes both optics and bioimaging.
The focus of USF research into optical physics is to study fundamental properties of light and to develop cutting-edge tools and applications for probing a variety of systems. Digital holography is an emerging technology for capturing 3D profiles of optical fields. Cellular structures can be profiled with nanometer precision to monitor, for example, chromosome volume change during laser microsurgery. As a new general imaging principle, digital holography opens up a host of new applications and technologies for imaging and studying tiniest nano and microstructures to astronomical objects of grandest scales.
One of the interesting projects that is going on in biophysics involves looking at amyloid fibril formation. The long-term goal is to try to see whether concepts of phase transition in physics are applicable to the growth of protein fibrils, which is very important for applications in Alzheimer's disease and in type 2 diabetes. These areas are the basis for a doctoral program in applied physics. The doctoral program combines the fundamental rigor of a traditional physics education in the foundations of physics with research possibilities in optical physics, biophysics, and materials physics.
Students have an excellent opportunity to participate in cutting-edge research, not only to underline fundamental science, but also to apply fundamental concepts towards more technological issues. This is extremely beneficial for our students when they seek employment.
USF Physics program provides me with valuable experience, knowledge, and skills necessary for the next stage of my career. Part of the PhD program, we have industrial practicum course that provides you with real life experience working in the company. Because of that, I was able to find that job and where I'm currently working.
Our graduate students in the Applied Physics degree program are not only involved in academic research in the lab, but they're also involved in national and international collaborations.
This spring, I'll be traveling to Slovakia to spend a month as a guest researcher at the Slovak Institute of Experimental Physics. So the experience of having international collaborators is one that's very common among the graduate physics students at USF.
Our graduate students are also very much a fabric of the Department of Physics.
Last year, several of us in the physics department decided to form a student organization focused on student success. We involve ourselves in orientation, develop student groups, and provide resources for new students.
Three of our doctoral students were selected to attend the 62nd Physics Nobel Laureates meeting in Lindau, Germany in the summer of 2012. Undergraduate research is a required component of the degree program in our department. In 2009, the Department of Physics received a three-year award from the National Science Foundation to establish an REU site in applied physics in our department. The research experience for undergraduates was then reviewed by the National Science Foundation and renewed for another 3 years, and continues to bring 10 to 12 undergraduates on an annual basis. These are times of intellectual excitement and professional and personal growth for our faculty, staff, and students. I'm particularly excited about the contributions that our students could make towards changing the future of science and technology.
All right, so that video gave you a snapshot and a very good overview of the department, but that was a few years ago. So since then, we've grown even more. And right now we have 33 full-time faculty. And the faculty body is very international. I'm from Russia. We have faculty from Sri Lanka, from India, from United States, of course. So it's a very international body of faculty. Right now in the program, we have 65 full-time graduate students. And as you can immediately see, the ratio of faculty to students is 1/2, which means that each faculty will have about 2 students. And this is actually very good for our students because we make sure that we as faculty have enough time to spend with our students, to monitor the progress of our students, and ultimately make sure that our students are successful. So we have about 10 postdoc scholars and visiting faculty at the moment. And once again, on this slide, you can see our state-of-the-art building. We're still very proud of it. You can see a lot of windows to allow for wonderful Florida sunshine year round. And on the other side of the building, there are laboratory spaces and offices for graduate students. All right, so let me move on and I'm gonna tell you a little bit more about the degrees that we offer. We offer master degree in applied physics, we offer PhD degree in applied physics, and we also offer PhD degree in applied physics with emphasis on medical physics. So I'm gonna start with the master program. Sometimes I get a question from the student, if I'm interested in PhD program, do I have to have a master's degree to apply? The answer is no. If you are interested in PhD studies, you should apply directly for PhD program with your 4-year bachelor degree. That is sufficient to start your PhD program, and you will be able to receive your master's degree as you progress toward your PhD degree. So after 2 or 3 years, you will earn enough credit to get a master's degree, and then you will proceed to the PhD degree. Now, if you are interested in master degree as a terminal degree, then I should also mention that it's quite all right to apply for that, but you have to be clear that this is your terminal degree that you are seeking. And also at the moment, our funding for just terminal master degree is limited. So if your intention is actually to pursue PhD and you applied for master in an error, please let me know and we will be able to transfer your application into the PhD pool. Now, PhD in applied physics, I'm gonna tell you quite a bit about that, and I will also tell you more about the medical physics concentration because I know that a lot of applicants are interested in that. So first of all, what does the applied physics program mean? It's rather unique. There is just about a dozen programs in the United States that specialize in the applied physics. So this program emphasizes the practical and engineering applications of theoretical and fundamental physics concepts. So it actually relies on three components. The first one is the research focus of the program, then the coursework of the program. And this is a very unique component of our applied physics program, which is industrial practical. And I'm gonna take you through all these three components. Let's start with the research focus. As you've already seen from the video, our department is very strong in biophysics, biomedical physics, and soft matter. We are also very strong in solid state and materials physics. We are strong in atomic, molecular, and optical physics, and of course, computational physics, and this is my area of expertise, in fact. But when you take a look at these strengths, you actually realize that we do not have component in astrophysics, or high energy physics, or particle physics. And there is a good reason for that, because these are not applied areas of physics. So that's why we choose not to specialize in those areas. The second component of our applied physics program is actually the coursework itself. As a first year graduate student, you will take a course in electromagnetic theory, which will reinforce the fundamentals of electromagnetic theory, and it will take you to the next level of understanding of the subject. But then in the next semester, you will have the opportunity to take a course in applied electromagnetic theory. And this is where you will learn how this fundamental knowledge that you gained can actually be applied for research. The same thing with quantum mechanics. So you will start your quantum mechanics in the first year with the reinforcement of the basic foundation, but then you will proceed with the applied quantum mechanics, where once again, you will learn how these fundamental concepts are applied in the real world. In terms of the electives, our electives are very diverse and they're really structured towards the research interest. So for example, you will find a course in biophysics, and let's say you don't know if there's something that you would like to research. So what you can do, you can take this course and see how much you like the subject. And then you may decide, look, I really love this one and I want to pursue research in biophysics. Or maybe you already start your research in biophysics and you will take this course just to make sure that you have adequate background, adequate knowledge in that particular area. The same thing with lasers and applications, atomic and molecular spectra. If you're interested in AMO, this is going to be a course for you to take, or solid state physics, or materials physics. Now, the course on the bottom is something that I really love to talk about. This is a rather unique but very important course. So if I were to ask you a question right now, why do you want to pursue PhD in physics? Why do you want to get PhD in physics? I talk to many students. I remember myself being a PhD student. I talk to a lot of applicants. And oftentimes, when I ask them that question, they tell me, you know what? I just love studying. I just love to learn. I just love to do research. I cannot imagine myself without doing that. And oftentimes, these are the main motivators that make us or encourage us to join PhD program. But think about it from a different perspective. You are about to invest 5, 6, or maybe even 7 years, best years of your life into this. And these are going to be the years of very hard work. These are going to be years of challenge and, you know, and obstacles that you have to overcome. You have to get some return on your investment. This is a big investment on your time, and you have to get some return from that. And from that point of view, it's very important to educate our students about different careers that will be available to them once they actually graduate with PhD in applied physics. And this is exactly what this course is designed for. So you will take it very early, probably in your first semester, and we will educate you about career paths that are available for you. It could be in industry, it could be in a national lab, it could be an academic career in university, but you will know these different options so that you're very well educated about the options that will be available for you. In addition to that, we will educate you about different fellowships and scholarships and internships opportunities that are available to you. We will teach you how to look for those opportunities and how to apply for those opportunities. And the expectation is that at the end of the semester, you already have an application ready to go that you can take and apply for an opportunity like that. And this is extremely important for you to be successful as a graduate student and eventually in your career. And in addition, we will educate you about the basic things, such as scientific writing, scientific reading, making presentations, and all that it takes to be successful in research. So this is an extremely important course, and all the students, they absolutely love this offering. All right. So now, industrial practicum, this is the third component that I mentioned, and actually this is one of the most important components of the applied physics program. What is unique to us is that we send all of our graduate students to spend anywhere from a few weeks to a few months in industry. It could be a company or it could be a national lab. It just cannot be a university. The idea behind the industrial practicum is that we want you to gain a real life experience. We want you to see things that are different from just standard research university environment. And this is a wonderful opportunity for you just, you know, to see things outside of university, to see how research is being done in industry environment or in a company, or to see how research is being done in a national lab. And we've had so many success stories from this industrial practicum, because oftentimes what happens, students go there, they make connections, and this is something that helped them to get their offers once they already graduate with their PhD. I can probably just mention one success story from my own group. I had a graduate student, and for his industrial practicum, actually, it was interesting because as he was finishing his program, his wife got pregnant and they were expecting a baby. And he told me, you know what, for my industrial practicum, I really have to stay here in Tampa because I want to be close to my wife. And we thought that probably the best option for him, his expertise was, of course, in computational physics. And we thought that perhaps the best option for him would be to do his industrial practicum at Moffitt Cancer Center that we actually have here on campus. So he went there, he designed computational algorithms, he was very successful. But the moral of this story is that after he graduated and applied for job offers, he got a very nice job offer from health industry sector, where he is a lead data quantitative analyst right now. And the reason why he got that job offer and he got it so quickly, because he had that experience in the healthcare center. So that really helps you, that really boosts your resume quite a bit. So here on the presentation, you can see a few titles of the industrial practicum site. You can see IBM, you can see Lawrence Berkeley National Lab, you can see quite a few sites, and students take very active part in that. They will be applying for those opportunities. They will be able to select what is it that is the most appealing to them. All right, so this map now shows basically a map of the industrial practicum sites. So you can see that we have very many sites in the United States, but we also have students successfully gone to Europe and doing the industrial practicum there. So this is extremely strong component of the program that will really help you quite a bit. Next, I'm going to talk a little bit about the PhD in applied physics with emphasis in the medical physics. I know that we have a lot of applications. We have a lot of people who are interested in this program. And this is indeed a very strong, very well-known at this point program in the United States. So this is a cooperative effort between the University of South Florida Department of Physics and Moffitt Cancer Center, which is very large cancer center here in the United States, very well-known. So the departments that are involved are the radiation oncology, diagnostic imaging, cancer imaging, and metabolism. So this program trains future applied physics scientists with a fundamental knowledge and provides research experience in the field of medical physics. So the graduates from this program are fully prepared to enter the field of or the medical residency, medical physics residency program. There is, however, one thing that is very important for you to know. Medical physics program, it's not medical physics emphasis program, it's a very small portion of our applied physics program. As I've already mentioned, right now we have about 65 graduate students in the program, and only 6 of them are the medical physics student. So it's about 10% of our student body. So what it also means, it means that in terms of admission, every cycle we approximately admit 10 new graduate students. So we admit at most one student for a medical physics emphasis. So this is a very competitive program. And oftentimes, the number of students that we are able to admit for this program is limited by the funding that we get from for that particular program. So when I talk to students, especially those who are interested in medical physics program, one thing occurs quite often. Sometimes when students apply for medical physics program, what they have in mind is a broader vision. They actually think more broadly in terms of the biophysics, in terms of the research, when you apply the fundamental physics knowledge to advance, you know, my biomedical applications to advance biophysics area. And if this is what your intention is, then I should mention that we are very strong in biophysics, but this is not medical physics, so you should not confuse the two. And if you are actually interested in biophysics, but not the medical physics, you need to let me know at this time and I will be able to transfer your application from medical physics to the biophysics. And you know, our regular applied physics program is just a little bit less competitive than the medical physics program. Okay. Where do our graduates go? So this is a chart, a pie chart that helps you to understand what happens to our graduate students once they graduate from us. You can see that a huge chunk or huge portion of this pie is actually students who go to postdoc positions after they complete a PhD with us. Then the next largest chunk here is students who go to industry. And this is not surprising at all because, you know, we are applied physics program. We make sure that our students can be very competitive at the job market in industry. And we have many success stories. I'm going to probably just mention one of my own students. After she graduated, she wanted to go to industry. She was also from Russia. But she wanted to apply her knowledge in computational physics in the area of finances. So here we have very strong partnership with the Citigroup, which is one of the largest financial institutions in the United States. And they just constantly ask us about our graduates because, you know, we really have very strong partnership with them. And she decided to go there. She was very successful. Just after 2 years there, she got promoted to VP. And right now she moved to New York, working with the same company, extremely successful, making probably 5 times the amount of money that I'm making. But, you know, that just shows you that we are able to place our students in those high profile positions. Then the next portion that we see here is teaching. Of course, this is expected. We see quite a bit of students going into the healthcare. And that is not surprising at all because we have medical physics emphasis. We have very strong biophysics research. So many of our graduates go there. And then you can see other areas. But if you, If you take a look at this chart as a whole, you can actually see that 95% of our graduates are employed. And usually that happens very quickly or even before they graduate from us. And I credit that success to our commitment to students, as well as to the fact that we are an applied physics program. So we really educate our students, or we provide them with skills and training that is valuable at the job market. All right, so just a quick job titles for our alumni: postdoctoral fellow, of course, research engineer, assistant professor, lead data analyst, chief financial officer, quantitative analyst, medical resident, software engineer, associate director, and of course, there are many more job titles. If at this point you are not convinced that the USF Applied Physics program is the best program for you to join, I'm going to highlight just a few other things to convince you. So we've been ranked among top US programs for student criteria. And this is NRC ranking. What that means that our students are really happy here. They're making good progress. They're successful in graduation and they're successful at finding jobs after they graduate. And this is reinforced in the second point here. So we have very high graduation rate. More than 95% of our students actually complete our program. And this is extremely high percentage. And the graduation placement rate, as I already mentioned, 95% of our students will have their job offer as they graduate. Another highlight, if you take a look at the average time that it takes to get a PhD in physics in the United States, it's 6.5 years. We are a year ahead of this national average, and this is something that I credit to our commitment to student success. Remember, I mentioned that we try to make sure that we always have adequate time for our students, we always monitor their progress, we make sure that they are progressing very well toward their degree. We offer multidisciplinary research, as you've already seen. This is extremely important point that we offer comprehensive financial assistantship. So what that means, you know, sometimes in my position, I hear a lot of what I call horror story when a student has to transfer from one program to another program because the funding finished in their institution. Horror story like that do not happen to us. We are very financially responsible for our students. Once you are in the program and you are in good academic standing, you're making good progress toward your degree, you have absolutely nothing to worry about the financial support. It will be there and we will guarantee that. I've already mentioned, I should mention that we waive your tuition and we provide the health insurance. There is one more point that I actually want to mention as far as financial assistantship is concerned. We have a lot of international applicants, and for our international applicants, you may not be aware that the cost of living in the United States, it depends greatly on the states. Let's say if you are getting $30,000 upstate New York, this is really not a whole lot. But if you're getting $25,000 in Florida, that will take you much further because Florida has among the lowest cost of living in the United States. So as you get your offers, please make sure that you compare your financial offer with the cost of living in the particular state, because this is ultimately what matters. As I said, we have among the lowest cost of living, which will really matter a lot to you. And on top of that, we don't even have state tax, which is another 10% of saving for you. So all these facts really matter. I mentioned that we've received this very high designation of preeminent state university. And last but not the least, that we are located in the beautiful Tampa Bay area. And at the end, I will show you a few pictures of that. A little bit more on the financial assistantship. So most of our offers, they will come with a financial assistantship. Most of the financial assistantship will be offered in the form of the teaching assistantship. What that means that you will teach labs, you will educate undergraduate students, and for that you will receive your compensation. So this is the standard offer. Very rarely you will get a research assistantship offer, but this is when you already have the advisor in the department. We also have a variety of fellowships and scholarships. We have MacKnight, which is available to students with Hispanic heritage and African American students. We have presidential fellowships, student success fellowships, and some other fellowships. So these nominations have already been done for this year, but I also know that quite a few of our applicants will come to reapply the next year. So make sure if you want to be nominated for one of those fellowships, make sure that you apply before the December 1st deadline so that we can screen those applications and we can nominate you for the fellowships. And this is something that is, of course, posted on our website. So I'm almost at the end, and one thing that I'd like to emphasize, that we are indeed located in one of the most beautiful places in the United States, in the state of Florida. We are very close to one of the best beaches in the United States. In fact, the beach that I have here is the Clearwater Beach, which has been ranked as number one beach in the United States. And you may be probably thinking, oh, you know, she's really crazy to tell us all about, you know, these wonderful things that you have in Florida because I'm coming there to study. Yes, but let me tell you one thing. Remember, this is going to be 5 or 6 years of your life, and you want to be productive. You want to be efficient, you want to be successful. But if you want to be all these three, the first thing that you have to be happy. And if you are not happy, you won't be able to be productive, you won't be able to be successful. So being happy is very important. And being close to all these wonderful attractions, places where you can relax and recharge, it may not appear very important right now, but believe me, this is something that you will learn to appreciate because this is important. So we have beautiful downtown, which is not too big, not too small. We have a lot of amusement park. Right now, this is a picture of Busch Gardens, which is a roller coaster park, which is right across our campus, so you can go there during the break. I'm just kidding. But you know, we also have a water park next to us, a lot of entertainment. And finally, if you love nature, there are a lot of things for you to do. Take a look. You can go to a farm and you can pick your own strawberries or blueberries or many other things like oranges and peaches. So there are a lot of things for you to do here. But I think I'm already out of the time that I wanted to dedicate to this presentation. At this point, I'm gonna ask you if you have any questions. If you have a question, please go ahead and type the question on the chat. I will then tell this question, verbalize this question, and will answer it to everyone. So, any questions? Once again, if you have a question, type a question on the chat. And okay, so here is, I have one question. How are mentoring and advising relationships generally made at USF? So once you are in our program and you're a first year student, in your first semester, we will send you through so-called lab rotation, where you get the opportunity to go to different research labs that are currently hiring students, and you get to talk to the professor, you get to talk to the graduate students, you get to take a look at the lab and see if this is something that is motivating for you, if this is something where you can be successful. And depending on that, you're going to talk to the professor, you're going to make that decision. But usually we have at least half the labs in the department open for the new students to join. And we give you the entire first year to make that decision, because we'd rather you take time to make that decision and then being successful than rush to the decision and then decide, you know what, this is not something that I would really like to do. Oh, there are just too many questions. Let me see, they're coming so quickly. One of the questions, when can we get to know the decision of acceptance? So right now we have reviewed most of the applications and we've been waiting for this teleconference because I wanted to talk to everyone at once and explain about our program. So we will be sending you requests for the interviews next week. and probably be done with the interviews in the next couple of weeks. And the first round of offers will go by the end of February. But even if you don't get the first round of offer, that does not mean that you're not getting into the program. Sometimes it just takes a little bit longer for you to get your offer. So please don't get discouraged. Is there any benefit of joining a private university than a public university? Actually, no. In the United States, as far as graduate program is concerned, because graduate program is funded program, so you won't really feel much of a difference between joining public versus private university. It will be very similar course offering. It will be very similar research environment. So at the graduate level, there is really no difference between the private and public university. Okay, so let me get another question here. Oh, there's a very good question about Bridge 2 courses. And probably most of you have not taken a look at our course offering yet, but this is another thing which is very unique to our program. So we actually pride ourselves on accepting students from different bachelors. Not necessarily physics, let's say electrical engineering or even math major, we are welcoming those students because we are truly multidisciplinary research program. But in order to make sure that those students are successful, we offer bridge courses. Bridge course is a course that bridge undergraduate and graduate level. Let's say if you're coming with engineering background and you have not taken quantum mechanics ever in your life, we just cannot place you in a graduate level quantum mechanics course because you won't be able to succeed. So what we will do, we will first place you into that bridge course that will allow you to get up to the speed, and then you can successfully take the full rigorous level graduate level quantum mechanics. So this is another unique component of our program. And because we have so many international students, I know that the educational systems are quite different. And sometimes we have a student from, I don't know, maybe India. And he says, you know what, I did take quantum mechanics, but I don't feel like, you know, that it was taught at the right level. Can I take this bridge course so that I can't be 100% sure that I'm ready for graduate quantum mechanics? And we have no problem doing that because we're very committed to our students being successful, whatever it takes. Okay, so let me see. Okay, so here is a very good question. Once admitted for the master program, is it possible to switch to PhD program without going through the normal admission procedure? Look, if you are interested in the PhD program and this is your intention, do the switch right now. So let me know and I will switch your application from the master to the PhD program. Because in order to be able to be admitted to PhD program, you only need 4-year bachelor. You don't need to have master. Okay, so it's much easier to start with a PhD program right away than start with a master and then switch to PhD. Do you conduct student exchange program? Yes, absolutely. But this is usually happening at the level of your own research group because we have a lot of collaborations, and through those collaborations, we're able to send students all over the world. For example, my own student, she is American, but last summer she went, for the entire summer, she went to China and she learned quite a few things from people there because right now they have one of the most modern computational resources there in China. Yes, absolutely. How closely do students work with faculty? Is it common for students and faculty to publish together? Oh yes, students work with faculty very, very close, and it will depend a little bit on the particular group. In my group, for example, we work very, very closely. And yes, students and faculty will publish together because usually the way the research is done, as you start, your faculty, your mentor will define a project for you and you start working on the project and your professor will mentor you through the project. And then toward the end, you have enough result to publish and professor and student will publish together, of course. Oh my God, they're just coming way too often. What level of support is provided for research publication and conferences? So for publications, no level of support is necessary because we publish in very reputable high impact journals. And those journals, they do not charge you for publication. So there's no cost associated with that. You know, for you, all that you want to be productive. You want to be as successful in terms of publications as possible and we'll take care of the rest. And in terms of conferences, your advisor will be responsible for that. And typically, you know, our groups have sufficient funding to send the students to conferences and wherever they feel appropriate to go. For the medical physics emphasis program, how often do students work at Moffitt Center, Cancer Center? They always work there because actually they take classes with us, but all the research will be done in the Moffitt Cancer Center because this is where their facilities are. What is the range of number of people in each group? It will depend on the group, but a typical group will have about two to three PhD students, maybe about three undergraduate students, and then a couple of postdocs. Is there any restriction on selecting advisor, or we can choose any of them? We as department, we don't restrict or limit or anything. In fact, we want you to be as flexible as possible in terms of your courses, in terms of the research group. But what also happens when an advisor wants or when advisor desires this, for the student to join his group, there should be sufficient funding available for that. So as long as there's funding available for that, that particular group is open and you can join that particular group. But once you're in the program in the first year, you know, you will have plenty of opportunities to see which groups are available, which groups are taking students. And as I mentioned, about half of them will be taking students, so you'll have no problem finding an advisor here. Do the graduate students get to stay on campus? Usually no. And this is something that, you know, once you get an offer from us, and once you are considering our offer, we will put you in touch with graduate students who are already in the program, and then they will educate you about the housing options and, you know, how to find apartment, how to find accommodation here. What are the supervision arrangements for medical physics at USF? I'm not quite sure what is meant by supervision, but if you are a medical physics student, your research advisor will be from the medical physics program, and he will take care of, you know, helping you with your research and helping you to progress towards your PhD. Do medical physics students take the same core classes? Yes, they do take the same core classes because ultimately it is PhD in applied physics, but they will take different electives as compared to the students in our regular applied physics program. Can anyone who already has a master's degree proceed directly to research without taking other courses? Well, usually the answer is no, because what happens, especially with international students, the education system our systems are sufficiently different so that we are not able to make that decision how whether the student is educated enough to proceed with our research. So usually you have to take the courses so that we are sure that your education is up to our standard, because ultimately you will be graduating from our program and we are responsible for your education. How many TA hours will be assigned? If you are getting TA offer, that will be 20 hours a week. So this is fairly standard. And by the way, TA's experience is a wonderful experience, which I actually encourage everyone to go through, because that is something that you can put on your resume, and this is a very good experience. What if after you have a successful career in industry, you make millions and millions of dollars, and then you retire and you want to teach? You go to a teaching place and you have that experience on your resume. Right, so this is something which is quite valuable. So I think I'm gonna just take a couple of more minutes, maybe